I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your
A blessed good evening. Shall we all rise? God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. There is a river whose stream shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations rage, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He maketh wars to cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Amen. Dearly beloved, I would like to welcome all who have assembled here today for the Thanksgiving service for the life of Hyacinth Margaret Clarke. I pray the service today will be a blessing and a comfort to the family and to all those who are bereaved in her passing, but also a means of drawing you closer to the one who gave her life and blessed her as an instrument in blessing others. This evening, we would like to invite you to silence all cell phones as far as possible, and also to follow the program as printed in your order of service. Those of you who would like to use the bathroom facilities, they are located to the back of this building through the last door down to the end of the corridor. And I pray that the service will be a blessing to you all. God bless.
Death divides, it hurts, it separates. But occasions like these allow us the opportunity to stand in solidarity one with another and offer words of comfort, support, and a shoulder on which to lie. It tells us that you're not alone, that we are not alone, that we are here for each other. We give strength one to another, and we give comfort one to another. Psalm 46 and verse 1 tells us that God is a refuge in strength, a very present help in trouble. This evening, I offer you God's strength and the support of each other as we rally one around another in order to help us to get through these difficult times. Let me say welcome to you. Welcome to the family, the Clarke, the Ray, the Fields, the Callender, the whole host of you. May God give you the strength to make it, and may you find the courage you need to stand firm at this time. Let us bow our prayer, our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, on occasions like these, we are reminded that when Lazarus died, that you empathize with the family. And John 11:35 tells us Jesus wept. Because you are God, you can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And because of the humanity of Jesus, you know that through which we are passing. So I'm asking you now to come by here and be near each member of the family, each friend, each visitor, and give them your peace, give them your comfort, give them hope beyond the grave. For we are reminded that if only in this life we have hope, then we are of all men most miserable. Margaret had that hope in Jesus. She knew you as Lord and Savior. And now she is resting in you, awaiting the resurrection. She is out of her pain. She is out of her troubles. But the relatives are here. And they have to go on. They have to put one foot in front of the other and make it through, struggling sometimes, rocking, maybe even resting a while, but have to go. Lord, I ask that you would give them your strength to make it, that you would soothe their minds and give them your peace, the peace which this world cannot give. Give them your comfort, O Lord. Put your arms of love and reassurance around them. Embrace them. May they feel actually your physical embrace, where they will hear you whispering in their ears, "You will make it through, my child. You will make it through." So I'm asking that you will come by here and grant us a heart of rejoicing, a heart of adoration, a heart to praise you because of your goodness towards us. Because we know that death is not the end. Death does not have the final say. Jesus defeated death when he rose from the dead. And we're reminded that he has the keys of death and the grave. May we be mindful of how we live and how we die, so that when you come, we would be able to say, "Lord, this is our God. We have waited for him and he will save us." But until then, tether us to you and make us strong and comforted in you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hymn number 462. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance. washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior that he loved. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior that he loved.
Scripture reading, Psalm 23, it gives me hope, it gives me peace, because I believe it gave my aunt hope and peace. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Here ends the scripture reading.
Should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my constant friend is he? His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on my doubts and fears. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Tempted, whenever clouds arise, when song gives place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to from care, he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
Our second scripture reading comes from Revelation chapter 21, reading from verses 1 to 4. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
When all my labors and trials are o'er, And I am safe on that beautiful shore. Just to be near the dear Lord I adore, that will through the ages be glory for me. Number 435, let's stand and sing our hearts out. Glory for me.
When by his grace I shall look on his face, that will be glory. Be glory for me. Dearly beloved, on behalf of my family, the officers and members of the 607 Adventist Church, we express sincere condolences and continued prayers for the family of the late Hyacinth Margaret Clarke. I got to meet Sister Clarke a number of times in ministry as I came to the district, and I realized that she was a person who was very easygoing. She took everything in life as it came and was not a complainer. Sometimes she may have had reason to, but she did not, because she found in God her refuge, and she was thankful for the kindness, which she would admit no one had to give, but every kindness she appreciated. Amen? But we are here to thank God for her legacy of hope, faith, and love. In meeting with her sisters, they testified that she loved with the love of a mother every member of the family. and each of them in their individual and distinctive ways. But she loved God first. And so today, we come thankful to God, but asking for His comfort and grace in our own lives. So bow your heads with me. Dear Lord, we come thanking you for the life that you have given that now rests in you. And we ask that you will speak to every heart here today, that we will recognize the gift that we have still. And may the life that Sister Clarke lived inspire us to overcome the obstacles we are faced with and live a life that counts to your glory, in Jesus' name. Life is a gift. Life is a gift. Now let me make a distinction between the gift of life and the reality of living. For you and I, the reality of living is full of a lot of things that God never intended for us in the first place. But the gift of life comes from God. Amen? One of the challenges with this dynamic is that the gift of life allows us to partake of the experience of living. If you are not alive, you can't live. I know some of my senior people tell me whenever they're having the pains that they don't mind them because they're above the ground. But to you and I today, as we face the experience of living, we will realize that there are some things in our living that do not complement life. They actually make life a challenge, difficult. But you see, God never meant for us to have those things, for God has given us life, and He has called us to life. Life was intended by God to be full, to be what? And blessed. Whenever you have a good, hearty meal, praise the name of the Lord. That was God's intention. Amen? He gave you teeth and tongue. He gave you belly too. And when you're satisfied, when you're what? That was God's intention. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, we are told, and the Lord God formed man of the what? Dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Praise the name of the Lord. In Genesis, we read again, this is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God created he him, male and female, created he them, and blessed them. And what? When you are blessed, it means that you're supposed to be happy. And called their name Adam in the day that God created them. God called man to life. Amen? But man chose to introduce into life things that God never intended. You have your beautiful baby. And as you prepare the way for that baby, you do everything. You child-proof your house, they say. You put in all the safety features. And then one day that baby sees a cockroach and grabs it and puts it in its mouth. And you are screaming because the baby didn't know any better. To him, it looked nice. And you don't know how it tastes, but to him, he might find that it tastes all right. But you know better, don't you? Because you know that roach is a danger. It's a what? It's a bad thing. It is even worse still when some people introduce to children things that they should not have exposure to. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 17 to 19, God rebukes Adam and Eve because they have brought into their experience something that God told them they should not have. God, in verse 7, he says, and Adam, he said, and unto Adam, he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Curse is the ground for thy sake. Sorrow shalt thou eat of it, and all of the days of thy life. All the days of thy? So life was good, until Adam decided he wanted something more than what God gave. The challenge with us and in our world today is that God has blessed us with a lot of good things. Amen? God bless us with the mango. A good thing. But we take it and make mango ice cream. Putting loads of sugar into something that is already beautiful. You can't do better than a Julie mango. Some people will say that it's a mango long, but you can't do better than a mango, but you would take that mango and introduce levels of sugar that were never, and you eat more of the ice cream than you eat of the mango, and then you wonder why you're getting. God never intended that. Thorns also, and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat of the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for thus thou art, and unto thus thou shalt return. So we are called to life, but as beings of choice, as beings of what? Now, people are always asking me, Pastor, why bad things happen? Because you see, we do a lot of foolish things with the choices that we have. If you look in the world today, you will realize that mankind makes almost all the problems themselves. Not God, you know. Let me show you what I'm talking about. God has given us sunshine, not true? And you know, we have discovered that if you spend time in the sun early in the morning, it's beneficial to your health. But you know, there's some of us who decide that we don't like the complexion we have. And we decide to roast ourselves. And then there's some of us who don't like the complexion we have. And we decide to bleach ourselves. God never intended that. And you chose to do that. And then you start to have cancer of the skin. Are you with me? It seems that God gives good things to us, and then we take choices, make choices with those things, and create problems for. So the call to life now brings with it an experience that God never intended for our lives to live. So in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, the wise man says, for the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything, neither have they any more a reward, for the memory of them is what? Forgotten. Also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished, neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is done under the sun. Because you see, God realized that sometimes we come so wrapped up in the foolishness of life that the only time sometimes the world sees peace is when we die. And sometimes the only time we know peace is when we die. Because we sometimes find ourselves in situations, sometimes not of our own making. Hello? You're driving your car comfortably along, and this is one of the realities of life too. You're driving your car comfortably along, and a man drunk comes along and hits you. And then you end up in hospital. Consequences of choice is not true, but sometimes not even your choice. So the living know that they shall die, and we know not only that we shall die, but we will get sick. If you're alive long enough, you will get sick, not true? But that is not God's intention. That's not God's plan. That was never God's purpose for you. So in this life, God has found a way. God has found a what? To correct the loss you have in living. He wants to give you back life. He wants to call you back to a life that is abundant. God has not given up on his original intention for a happy life. And that is what the church should always remember we're here for. To give people hope. To give people what? You see, God has given to the church the responsibility to tell the world that all the suffering and pain and foolishness and wars and strife that mankind has created was never God's plan. God has a better way. So Christians should live different. Hello? Christians should be peacemakers. Christians should be givers. Christians should be happy. I'm a pastor. I know that some of the most unhappy people sometimes are people who come to church. And it's unfortunate because when you meet them, you don't want to come to church either. But I've learned that their unhappiness has nothing to do with God. Because God makes people happy. God heals the brokenhearted. He heals the what? He has made the blind to see. He takes those who are sad and he lifts up their head. And sometimes, you know what I've discovered? That the people with the most are sometimes the most unhappy. And people who have the challenges and the difficulties are happier because they realize that God never fails them. He sees them through the difficulties of their day-to-day experience. He has been able to be with them. So, in this world, hardship, problems, and difficulties do not have to make you unhappy every day. Because there's a God who gives you his blessing. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul puts it this simple way. He says, for since by one man, by what? Came death. By man came also the resurrection of the dead. So what the church is trying to give to the world is that there is a way to reverse all of the foolishness that sin has caused, that bad choices have created. We are saying to the world that when we come and know Jesus, we have an answer to every problem. Amen? Jesus is the answer. And some people say, but Pastor, how could Jesus be the answer to everything? You see, when Jesus is in the heart of a human being, they do things that otherwise they will not do. And they do not do things that they otherwise would do. Jesus changes the life. Jesus what? And he makes you change your trajectory. When you are born, you may be destined to die. But when you find Jesus, you're destined to live. John chapter 3 verse 16 puts it this way. For God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So watch what he adds on. He says, and God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Love changes everything. I used to be at school. And when I was at school, we lived in a dorm, and the young fellas used to stay up late at night and then have difficulty waking up in the morning. But what would happen is that most often than not, one of these young fellas would fall in love. Hello? And there's something about love that changes everything. So now this young fella who is in love wants to see this young lady first thing in the morning. Uh-oh. And in the morning when the young lady comes and knocks and calls for him, his physical body wants to sleep, but his mental body wants to see the young lady. So you know what I've discovered? That love changes. Because now at night, when he would be tempted to stay up, he goes to sleep. Because he wants to feel a certain way in the morning to get up to see the young lady. God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should have what? And if you want to see God, you live a different life. You live a what? You live different in the night from the way you want to be in the day, because you want God
to see you as you want to see God. Amen? Listen to how it goes. The call comes, but someone must answer that call. To receive the blessing it affords, a call is only as good as the use you make of it. If you miss the call, if you what? So God is calling us. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. And all that ever came after me are thieves and robbers. Are what? So people may have let you down and hurt you and disappointed you. But don't let their actions determine how you relate to God. Know God for your? Listen, God is so good that he makes the sun to rise on people who don't even like him. He waters the garden of people who deny him. Isn't that a good God? Because I tell you, some of you would even let their children know that if they show disrespect for you, they ain't staying in your house. Are you with me? Every now and again, me and my son have a little discussion because we know when children get a certain age, they want their own space. But you know the challenge they have. How can you have your space in my house? And some of us try to treat God the same way. You are in God's good world, but you don't want anything to do with God. You don't talk to God. You don't say nothing. And God is the one who gave you life. Everything you have comes from? Some people say, but you're not my cell phone. But everything that any cell phone comes out to the ground that God made. Are you with me? So even though you even owe your cell phone to God. So, God wants us to know him. Jesus says, my sheep know my voice. Amen? He says, the thief cometh but to steal and to kill and to destroy. So when you've been hurt, know that there's pain in the world. Know that there's hurt in the world. Know that there's disappointment in the world. But there's still God. For Jesus says, I am come that they may have life. And that they may have it what? More abundantly. So God gave us marriage, not hurt. God gave us love, not hate. God gave us blessing, not sparsity and hurt and loss. God gives us these things. And whenever we see a hurricane coming, we realize that we need God. Because it doesn't matter how many votes you got in the last election, you cannot stop the hurricane. It doesn't matter whether you're opposition or government. When the hurricane comes, all is one. When COVID came, it showed no distinction. It showed no what? But God is good. Some of us were the weakest of the weak, and we made it through COVID. And some of the strongest of the strong did not. For some of them, God put them to rest. God put them to what? Because after COVID, it's something else. But for some, we realize that God has been more good to us than we deserve. So he's calling us still. He's what? How should you relate to God's call? Jesus demonstrates and instructs us on how to respond to God's call. How to what? I know some persons who tell me, Pastor, I don't know how to know God. But let me share a little brief message with you today. If you forget everything, don't forget this. Firstly, Jesus wants you to know who is calling you. He wants you to what? Like a person writing you a letter from the States. When you know who the person is, you know what they're saying can be trusted. Amen? The Bible is God's letter to you. It tells you every day, and as you study it, it gives you more and more information about who God is and how he is. So in John chapter 11, verse 25 to 27, Jesus meets Martha. He meets who? And as he's talking to Martha, he wants her to understand that he is the power that makes the difference in the lives of those who put their confidence in him. Martha is grief-stricken. Lazarus has died. Death is a reality, but Jesus is a reality too. So Jesus says unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me. He that what? Doesn't say he that went to church. Don't get messed up with that. Some people think that the more they go to church, the closer they are to God. But it's not just going into my house that makes you and I friends. It's the relationship we share. Amen? So there's some people who go to church regularly but don't get very close to God. So when you go to church, make sure you know the person who the church belongs to. Amen? So here it is. Whosoever believeth in me, he whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die, Jesus says. And when Jesus says that, somebody said, but Lazarus just died. But Jesus is giving you a little message. He's giving you this. Believeth thou this? Martha turns to Jesus and she said, yeah, Lord. She says what? Her brother is in the ground dead. And she just said, I believe that those who believe in you will never die. And then she explains. Then she what? You see, you have to not only know God, but you have to be able to testify what you know of God. Jesus looks at her and he listens to her words and she says, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. She is saying that Jesus is not just a man. Jesus is not just any man. Jesus is not even just a teacher. He is the Savior of the world. He is God incarnate. He is what? When you know God, it's like having electricity. It's like having what? Have you ever been in your house when the electricity went off? Anybody? I know some of you never had your electricity off. That's all right. But when your electricity goes off, doesn't your house feel different? All of a sudden, all the things you have seem like nothing. Are you with me? You got that big 20-something inch TVs? Somebody said 20 small, Pastor. And now the electricity is off. It's like a big rock. You got that nice two-door, you know, that gives you ice and water. And now, ain't even giving you. You see, having God in your life is like having electricity in your house. Everything works. Amen. Are you with me? Amen. Martha is connected. She knows who Jesus is. And Jesus turns to her and he gives her the last delivery. He says, listen. Remove the stone. What's that? He turns to them and he's saying to them, I am the resurrection and the life, and I tell you to remove the stone. Sometimes we allow the things in our lives to keep us from God. Someone said or did something to us, and because of that, we don't want anything to do with God. Does that make sense? If this brother here gives me $100, should I thank this brother? You'll be vexed, no? That you give me and I thank him? But if this brother slaps me, should I slap the other brother? Sometimes God has not done you anything wrong and you upset with God. Actually, God is the only person still doing you something good. Here it is. Jesus tells them, remove the stone. Give me a chance at what is going on in your life, as bad as it may be. Lazarus has been dead 4 days. He is now stinking. And some people would say he's beyond coming back. But Jesus is the resurrection and the... You see, when Jesus gets into your situation, you get a new experience one time. So here's what Jesus does. Can a dead man hear? No. So you know what it takes for a dead man to hear Jesus? Now, let me give you this one. Brother, I love these things in God's word. But when you think about it, if you are dead and decomposing, you can't hear. So Jesus first has to give you the power to hear. And then he has to let you hear the call. Isn't he powerful? When you can't do nothing for yourself, Jesus gives you back your life. He gives you life enough to hear him. And when you respond to his call, he gives you everlasting life. So when Jesus gets them to roll the stone away, he says, Lazarus, come forth. He says what? Now let me explain how powerful that is. It means that no matter what situation you are in right now, do not give up hope. Because God can help you in it. If God can raise a dead man, he can do anything. He can do what? So here is it. Lazarus hears Jesus by the power of God. And then Lazarus comes to the door of the tomb by the power of God. And then God tells everybody. God tells what? God tells everybody, loose him and let him go. Now let me explain what that means. That means when a person is overcoming something, let them go. We have a tendency in Barbados of reminding people where they come from. Trying to keep people remembering your past. Keep people remembering their mistakes. All the things they did wrong. But let me tell you something, God has better hope than that. When God frees you, you are free. That's what salvation is about. That's what? So the song says, I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new man. All things are, I'm born again. More than a conqueror, that's what I am. I'm a new I'm a brand new man. Lazarus has come forth from the grave, not by his power, but by the power of God. Not by the will of others, but by the power of God. Lazarus has been set free. And when God has made you free, you are free. Hear the voice of God in your situation. And follow what God says. God gives you the ability to hear the call, so you have it. And when you have the ability to hear the call, answer the call. When Lazarus comes forth and he is given the wonderful privilege to walk again among the living, God has set before you and me an example of what we need to do when we come to Jesus Christ. When you have accepted Jesus, walk in life. Don't keep on the old clothes. Don't keep on the old ways. Walk in life. You used to smoke and it made you sick. God healed you. The things I used to do, I do them. You used to carry on with women and God set you free. Stay free. Take off the grave clothes. Take off the what? Margaret did something that many of you may not have understood. But I want to just underline it at this point. She lived with her challenges and she lived. She what? She lived. Some of us are always complaining and we don't have anything to complain about. We keep letting everything get in the way of us forgiving people and loving people and caring for people. Live your life to the glory of God. Stop complaining and stop finding excuses and live your life. I was watching a video the other day, a man has no feet and he preaching. Well, you know, even if I lose one of my feet, I still preaching. I saw a man who had no hands and he driving car. Well, I plan to drive car too. Sometimes we allow the difficulties of life to get in the way of the living that we need to live. And God has given us greater strength than that, greater power than that, greater victory than that. So if you take anything from the life of Sister Margaret, take that she lived her life to the best that she could to the world. My friends, hear the call. Job understood the call. Job what? Job had lost everything. And I keep telling people, I hear people that kill themselves because they don't have any money. Well, that's a daily thing for some of us. No money? Amen? Live your life. Listen to what Job said. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand in the latter day upon the earth, and though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. Paul understood the call of life in Jesus. Paul says, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a what? He will call. And not only Paul, but he says, and the dead in Christ shall rise. And we which are alive. Amen? We who are alive and remain shall be caught up in the clouds together to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the John. Comes to us with another testimony. And I'm told if you have three witnesses, you got good testimony. So you've heard Job, you've heard Paul, now hear John. John says, the power of his call is of such that I've already seen the fulfillment. I've already seen the what? John is saying, not only is his call intact, but it's already happened. Listen to what John says. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write. Blessed are the dead. Blessed are the what? Who die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors. They may what? In other words, nobody going nowhere up nor down to work. When you go, you're resting. When you go, you're what? So you're not going up to work nor down to work. Work done. Work what? Done. It's over for this world. But you are resting until he comes. Here's what it says. For their works do follow them. And I looked, and behold, a white cloud. A what? And upon the cloud sat one unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden cloud, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him that sat in the cloud, trust in thy sickle and reap, for the time is come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. For the harvest of the earth is what? Ripe. And he that sat on the cloud trust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. God wants to have a harvest of people who are looking forward to living with him. God wants a church that is preparing to meet him. And you know what the church is about? The church is called the called out. It's called the what? Ecclesia. The called out. It means that you can't be in the world, of the world, and in the church. You have to be different. You have to be what? Because if you're still taking part of the things that make life hard, how can you take part of the things that make life better? You got to make a choice. You got to make a what? God calls. You choose to answer. And there's some person saying today, but Pastor, I don't know if I'm ready to answer. Let me tell you something. Answer as soon as you get the call. Because sometimes the evening call may be too late. The call to accept and know Jesus as our Lord and Savior is real and powerful in this life. It strengthens the capacity of the living to overcome the daily battle lines we face. When we accept the call, don't live your life without it. It's free. It's what? Free. because it's been paid for. He has given it to you and to me. But we have to accept the call. We have to what? So, today, are you willing to accept the call? Are you willing to live your life and not keep finding excuses why you can't? Are you willing to face the fact that, yes, you may have difficulties and challenges, but you serve a risen Savior who is in the world today? And he wants to help you through your difficulty. He wants to what? Some person may say, well, I don't need no help. But that's not true. You know that. Because there's some mornings you can't even wake up yourself. But praise be to God. He makes his grace to shine upon you. And he is gracious unto you. He's calling you. He's what? Sister Margaret made her peace with him. She accepted his call. She what? And yes, I will not put her, as I told you, up nor down. Her work done. But she rests. She what? She rests. And he is faithful. He is what? I like to tell at least one story. I remember once upon a time, I was supposed to go to the airport to catch a flight. But somebody had to give me a call to wake me up. You know that call? The flight was an early morning flight. And if you know anything about early morning flight, you don't sleep well the night before. Because you're anticipating, right? So you must understand there's a certain anxiety when you're waiting for the call. So I didn't sleep well the night, and I dropped sleep for the morning. And when I stirred, when I stirred, it was bright. Oh boy, it was bright. So I called the person who was to call me. And the person told me they called, but I didn't answer the call. So then I made a call of my own. I called the airport. And as I was calling the airport, I heard over the line, "This is the final boarding call." And I told the lady on the line, "I am supposed to be on that flight." And she said, "Where are you, sir?" I said, "I home." And she said, "Well, sir, I'd like to let you know you're not going to be on that flight." Well, that's true. Some of us are waiting to get a call. But you have to be at the airport in order to be a part of the flight. Don't keep waiting for the call. Answer the call. Amen? Amen? Be ready that when you hear the final call, you're where you're supposed to. So that when Jesus comes, I can see you and you can see me. And we can experience everlasting hope together.
Be not dismayed, whatever betide. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you. To Pauline and Cora and Barbara and Anne and Yvonne, this song is for you. God will take care of you. He will give you the strength to make it. Let's stand and join hands and hearts and voices together as we sing our final hymn, hymn number 99, God will take care of you.
Not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you.
Family of our dear sister Margaret, friends and relations, a church, a community. And I ask, dear Lord, that today, as we have given thanks for the legacy of her life, that you will also be near to us as you were with her. Lord, we don't have anything to commend ourselves to thee, but we have heard today that you call out to us. May we answer your call. May we yield our lives to thee, giving you the opportunity to help us, to heal us, to save us, that we may find that life most abundant, promised in your word, consecrated through the sacrifice of Calvary, and which we are looking forward to fulfilling in eternal life and eternal hope when you shall come. Lord, bless the family with your comfort, and may they live in hope of your second coming. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ready? Good?
Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow he flees and never stays. In the midst of life we are in death. To whom can we turn for help? But to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer, forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Hyacinth, and we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our sister Hyacinth and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray, Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto Hyacinth, O Lord. Perpetual shine upon her. May she and all the faithful departed, through the tender mercies of God, rest in peace. the hymn, Blessed Assurance.
Washed in his blood.
The Lord be with you. Hear, Lord, the praise of your people as we remember before you Hyacinth, our sister, and grant that we who confess your name on earth may with her be made perfect in the kingdom of your glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious unto her. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon her and give her peace. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. Now on behalf of the Clarke's family, they wish to express sincere thanks and appreciation for your love and support during this time of bereavement. There will be no reception after the burial, since the relatives would prefer to spend time together in quiet reflection. You're assured of the church's prayers and of the church's support in this, your time of bereavement. Do get home safe and do stay safe. Thank you.